All right, so as I mentioned, our mission is to equip Christians to explain why they believe what they believe about marriage and family so that we can build a civilization of love. Our next awardee shows how to put that knowledge into action. Our next awardee is Jeff Morgan for the Activist of the Year. Jeff Morgan is a tireless activist for divorce reform, particularly at the state level in Texas. Jeff has seen divorce from the perspective of a child, that is, his parents were divorced. He has also been an abandoned, reluctantly divorced spouse. He is a parent of children who are dealing with the aftermaths of divorce, and he is also a grandparent who can no longer see his grandchildren because of grandparent alienation. All the different facets of the divorce experience in modern America. Jeff's background prepared him for his work. He graduated from Western Seminary in Portland, Oregon. He was a missionary in the Middle East for 5 years, and he has an MBA. He worked on Rick Santorum's campaign in 2011-2012, in part because of Santorum's strong pro-life values. Shortly after his campaign, Jeff's wife filed for no-fault divorce, and Jeff became aware of how little the state does to protect marriage and families. So Jeff first reached out to Texas Representative Matthew Krause in 2013. So very early on, he reached out to Representative Matt Krause. But it wasn't until 2017 that Jeff had the opportunity to testify in Texas legislature about the need for divorce reform. But in the intervening years, Jeff has been working in the background, networking, attending conferences, explaining the need for divorce reform. Here he is with the Texas Supreme Court Justices Jimmy Blakecock and John Devine at the Texas Values Forum. Jeff was very excited to get to meet and chat with Justice Devine about one of the dissents that he wrote in 2015. Not many people are following stuff that closely, and that's a tribute to Jeff's tenacity on this issue that he knew that. One of Jeff's favorite teaching tools, and you'll probably see it if you're here tomorrow, is that video camera. He just sets up that camera and he gets people talking on tape. He now has over 600 videos on his YouTube channel, including videos with me and with Steve Baskerville and Matthew Johnston, who will be on the program tomorrow. So there's several videos of those that you can see. Jeff and I first met in person. We've known each other online and by phone and so on. But we first met in person at a mass resistance conference at Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary in Fort Worth. And when I asked Jeff, how did you get involved? He said, well, one of the things Rick Santorum used to say when I asked him about what we should do is he says, I don't know, do something. And Jeff said, I figured that was easy enough, so that's how I got started. I'm doing something. So please, Jeff has certainly showed us all how to do something. Please join me in welcoming Ruth Institute. Activist of the Year Award. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you. So, have a seat. So, Jeff, tell us a little bit about your experience as an abandoned spouse and what got you interested in getting involved in this.
So, first off, I'd like to thank Stephen Baskerville, because when I was going through this issue of no-fault divorce, I kept on thinking something's wrong. This cannot be this bad. And I was reading Stephen Baskerville's book, Taken into Custody. I could only read about one or two pages at a time because I saw everything he was saying was true. That as far as when you go through this, there's no defense. There is no defense, no matter what you bring forth as evidence, it does not make a difference. There was a time, Dr. Morse, that I thought it almost would have been preferable to have been accused of either rape or murder. Because number one, you have the presumption of innocence. Number two, the opposition has to bring some type of proof forth. Plus you get due process.
Right.
And then if you're declared innocent, your name is cleared. No fault divorce, you get none of this.
Do you know, one of the interesting things that's come up, I think from somebody that you introduced me to actually, is you know, can you think of any other civil offense or civil issue where one side always wins? You know, you walk into court and you know which side is going to win. The government always takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. There's nothing like, there's no other thing that's like that.
Right, and that has been the case that I found too. I mean, I've said that the state ends up re-victimizing the person who was being divorced. So I understand that there may be some people that want to mutually consent to get a divorce. That's one thing. But unilateral no-fault divorce, what is unilateral no-fault divorce? It's when one person forces divorce upon a spouse. The interesting thing about unilateral no-fault divorce is that in the 20th century, it was first introduced in Bolshevik Russia by Vladimir Lenin. And it is amazing that in that society, this destruction was so bad that they had to have a national debate over what should we do, should we keep this or not? And yet that is the same, for all intents and purposes, that is the exact same divorce doctrine we have through almost every state in America and in Texas. And you know, what we're trying to do is, this is a very, look at how minor we're talking about. We try to put forth legislation that would say, number one, if two people want to go through a no-fault divorce, there has to be mutual agreement. You can't force divorce on a spouse. And the second thing is that you would extend the waiting period, because in many instances, there are unnecessary divorces that could actually, marriages could be restored, families could be kept intact. And this is, comes from people that you would not expect it to come from. They said there are unnecessary divorces. In fact, some people have estimated up to 40% of those marriages could actually be restored, those families kept intact. I always say to people, I say a lot of times to people, marriage is for the children, divorce is for adults. Children before adults. That's what we need to do. In our state of Texas, all you have to do is say, well, I want a divorce. You don't have to have any facts. You don't have to have any evidence. You could just say, well, I just don't feel like I want to be married.
Right.
And the state, without exception, 100% of the time, will side with the person filing for divorce. And the person who may say, wait a minute, I didn't do anything. Why am I being divorced? That person will always lose. It's guaranteed. And it's very easy to prove. In the last 5 years, in the state of Texas, can you find 3 times that a judge denied a divorce? You cannot find it. But the interesting thing was that I was at a conference a few weeks ago, and this one attorney said to me, well, wait a minute, there was an instance. Back in 1991.
That kind of tells you all you need to know right there, right?
So here she's trying to refute me, but she's making my point.
Right.
One case from 28 years ago, a judge denied a divorce, and but I think they still ended up divorced anyway. But.
So there are many people in this room who are who have been impacted by divorce in various ways.
Right.
And I wonder if you could say a few words maybe about how people could get involved, you know, how an ordinary person could do something to contribute.
So this is an ordinary person. As you mentioned, Dr. Morse, I said after I went through it, number one, I had to get healed. I didn't know how long that would take, but I figured God would bring me through. I had faith in that. But the second thing was, I want to stop this because I do not want to see this family destruction industry continue on. I don't want to see it affect my kids, and I sure don't want to see it affect my grandkids. So, you know, and Senator Santorum used to say to people that asked him, what can I do? He would say, do something. And I thought, okay, I can do something. I don't know what that's going to be, but I can do something.
Right.
And then there was a time that I was praying that I felt like God had told me, what is that in your hand? I said, a camera. He said, well, use it. And I'm thinking, oh, that's great, but I didn't even know how to use the camera at that point. So
he knows how to use the camera.
It's a very cheap camera. It's like a W button there. But that's what I started to do. And because of that, I've met some outstanding people. Amazing people.
Tell us about some of the people that you might not expect who are involved in or somehow interested in divorce reform.
So I'm not exactly sure because, well, okay, I'll, some of the people that are involved in it right now, they come from it from a different angle because I know a lot of people that have been through divorce, did not want it, and then they find out the state takes their kids away. The state takes their house away. The state basically says in the future, your income has to go to your ex-spouse, whether it be a mother or a father, a husband or a wife, because you have to support them either with alimony or child support. And a lot of people are saying this isn't right, but I've said the action of unilateral divorce is the issue that we need to be addressing. These other things that come from it are all consequences because of the initial action that has taken place. So I find a lot of people there. I guess the interesting thing that I found is this, that on YouTube, if you go to unilateral divorce, I guess 80% of those videos are mine. I don't know. And again, I mean, I just started to say, I've got to do something. I don't know what it is. Some of them are probably not very good, but I had to start talking about the issue. And the thing that I found the most is the doors that it's opened. The tremendous people that I have met that that have been, I mean, some of them are here. And I think to myself, how can I even be numbered among these people? But I want to thank all of them, because there have been so many people that have been supportive or have said, you know, you're giving voice to something that we've thought but we couldn't do anything about.
Is there anybody in particular you want to give a shout out to in the internet audience, or give a thumbs up to, any organization, anything like that?
Well, there's a lot of people here. As far as the people out there, you know, the people in Texas, many of you know me, some people nationwide. We've been working not just in divorce reform, but in other areas. But I would like to give a shout out to, if you don't mind, are my two grandchildren, Cruz and Gideon. And I love them. And, you know, when you look at the devastation that can be caused, and when you look at the way people's characters will change to defend the indefensible, mm-hmm. It is horrendous. I also would like to give a shout out to my own home church, if you don't mind. Watermark Church, the pastor up there, Todd Wagner, he's also very solid on the issue of no-fault divorce. Most churches have just punted on this. They've said we've accommodated culture. But now we actually are seeing people in the past that are starting to say this is wrong, and we need the church, Protestant, Catholic, Orthodox, everybody involved. If we all do a little bit, we can become a wave that they can't stop.
Well, you know, I really agree with that. And, you know, the bags that you have, if you look inside your conference bag, I don't have it with me right now. If you look inside your conference bag, there's a pamphlet called Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? That's a rhetorical question. Everybody knows a survivor of the sexual revolution. And then there's another pamphlet called Counting the Casualties. And if you look at those two brochures, what you'll see is there are millions of people who've been harmed by divorce. Okay, there are we estimate 45 million children of divorce. Just looking at over the years, you know, about a million per year, kids losing their parents and so on and so forth. And so part of our thought process here at the Ruth Institute is that if you could get those people who've been victimized by the sexual revolution, people who've been harmed, and you could get them all kind of marching in the same direction, like, we could really get something done. You know, if we could get the abandoned spouses and the reluctantly divorced and the people who were upset about their hookup culture experience or their cohabitation experience, if we could just get some of these people lined up and moving in the same direction, that's a constituency. You know, there's a lot of possibilities.
And the pro-life people.
Absolutely.
Because what happened under Bolshevik Russia is after the no-fault divorce came into existence, there was a skyrocketing abortion rate, which they'd never had. We've had the same thing happen in America, but the problem was this. No-fault divorce was instituted state by state over a number of years. Abortion was a national thing, so we focused on abortion, rightly so, but abortion is still a symptom or something that has happened because of the no-fault divorce and the sexual revolution talked about. So if you are pro-life, you need to be for the repeal of no-fault divorce, because it's the children of divorce that are more often become pregnant outside of marriage.
No kidding. And I mean, there's just layers and layers of it, you know. In fact, if you look at the banner that we have here, last year our theme was Defend the Family, Life Depends on It.
Amen.
Right? See, and so the pro-life movement and the pro-marriage, pro-family movement need to be working in tandem.
Absolutely.
So that's a very important point. So look at tomorrow. Jeff will be speaking on the panel on divorce reform, there's legal strategies for divorce reform. There'll be three people talking, and he'll be one of them. The other two will be Chris Brennan, an attorney from New Jersey, and Matthew Johnston, who's, I think, right behind me. There's Matthew. And you'll also have the opportunity to hear Dr. Steve Baskerville first thing in the morning, who, in my opinion, is the great theorist of this whole thing, the great genius of the whole thing. He's back there. I think Steve's a genius. His books are back there too, so you can take those with you. But I would just like to thank you for honoring us with your presence, Jeff. We're so tickled that you're here.
Well, and thank you. I was, when you contacted me, I was shocked and surprised. And just thank you. I never would have anticipated being numbered among the people that are here. And the people that I admire and the people that helped me through a very difficult time. So thank you.
Well, you're so welcome, Jeff.